Hello everybody, welcome back. In the previous video, I introduced the Dirac equation in a similar style as what you find in many physics textbooks. Of course, I left out a lot of material. I didn't really tell you what the physics of the spin is about. On the other hand, there's no point in doing so here because you find it nicely in many physics textbooks. And you find a few suggestions on our website. Here I want to proceed by explaining a few mathematical structures underlying the Dirac equation. I also want to introduce a convenient notation, which we will use later on. Let me first of all quickly recall where we are. So we consider the Dirac equation in Minkowski space, and we wrote it as d minus m psi is equal to zero, where m is the rest mass, and the solution psi was, well, we considered smooth solutions with spatially compact support, and this Dirac wave function takes values in C4, so it has four complex components. The Dirac operator d could be written as I gamma j dj plus, for example, an electromagnetic potential. Let me write this here in a slightly more general form, plus B, where B contains potentials. For example, B is gamma J Aj. If one considers the Dirac equation in the presence of an external electromagnetic field. In the presence of an electromagnetic potential. Okay, so this is the general setup. Now for a mathematician, the formulation here is not quite convincing. So we are working here with four component complex wave functions, but this depends on the choice of bases. It is better to replace C4 here by an abstract vector space. And this is the so-called spinner space. So let me define this. So we define the spinner space, and we denote it by S. And it's endowed with an indefinite inner product, which we denote like this. By, well, first of all, S is a four-dimensional complex vector space. Well, and then this inner product is an inner product of signature 2, 2, the so-called spin inner product. Okay, so now we have the spinner space and the corresponding spin inner product, and well, if one chooses now a pseudo orthonormal basis of the spinner space, well, then S is of course identified with C4, and the spin inner product takes the same form as what we used as the definition in the last video, namely the spin inner product of, say, psi and phi can be written as the sum from alpha equal 1 to 4 s alpha psi alpha bar times phi alpha, where s1 and s2 are equal to 1. n s3 equal s4 equal to minus 1. This means choosing such a pseudo-orthonormal basis, we get back to the setting last time. Of course, here nothing really changed. I mean, we only made the setting a bit nicer. In particular, now the Dirac wave function is a smooth function mapping with spatially compact support from M to the spinner space. This is of advantage, for example, if one wants to analyze the Lorentz invariance of the Dirac equation. Well, if you perform a Lorentz transformation, so a change of reference frame, this corresponds to the change of a pseudo-orthonormal basis or in Minkowski space, a Lorentz boost, for example. Okay, and then the point is that if one also needs to change the basis of the spinner space accordingly. So if then these bases of Minkowski space and of the spinner space are changed in the appropriate way, then the Dirac equation looks the same in the two reference frames. And this is what one means by Lorentz invariance of the Dirac equation. I mean, I don't want to enter any computational details. In fact, you find it as an exercise on the website to work this out in detail. Okay, so this is the first step. Now there's one more thing which is not quite convincing, namely, it is not so good to work only with one spinner space. It is better to think of one spinner space for each space-time point. This is mainly of advantage in curved space-time, but I think it's also good to introduce this already now because it gives a kind of more convincing, it's a bit more convincing conceptually. So this means instead of having just one spin space, we want to attach one spinner space at each space-time point. And this leads to the concept of the spinner bundle and sections therein. I mean, here we don't really need to introduce what a vector bundle and what sections are. It's in fact quite simple, but I will nevertheless use these bit more general notions. Okay, so now what is the spinner bundle? Well, the spinner bundle is simply the Cartesian product, M cross S. And we also denote this by SM. SM, and this is defined by M cross S. Well, and as I said, the concept is that we attach the spinner space to each space-time point. So, in this spinner space is denoted by SXM, and this is then simply X cross S. So, this is again a four-dimensional complex vector space. I mean, basically, like this base point X is kept fixed, and the vector space operations take place here in the spinner space. So this is what we call the spinner space at the point X. Well, and then obviously the spinner bundle is the union of all these spinner spaces. Okay, and well, if one does this more abstractly, then I would have to give this a topology and introduce bundle charts and all of that. But we don't need this here. I think this is sufficient for our purposes here. Good, then what is a wave function? Well, a wave function is, in an abstract notation, a section in the spinner bundle. And this is something quite simple. So this is a mapping here from M to SM, where to every space-time point, we associate Well, the wave function at this space-time point, and this should then be an element in the corresponding spinner space. Okay. And we also denote these wave functions by, well, here, smooth, spatially compact of m, sm. So this is the notation. And sometimes I call it a section in the spinner bundle. But as I said, we don't really need to do this to understand this in a more general setting. So all I mean here is such a mapping. Good. Now let me say a few more words on the Dirac current, current conservation, the resulting scalar product, the Hilbert space of Dirac solutions, and all of that. I mean, in the last video, I also introduced the Dirac current. So let me now write it like this. So we have jk of x defined by psi gamma k psi evaluated at the spacetime point x. Maybe I should also put an argument x here. And this index x denotes that this is the inner product on the spinner space at the point x. So this is the Dirac current. So this is a vector field in Minkowski space. And then we saw that for solutions of a Dirac equation, this vector field is divergence free. Dk jk of x is equal to zero. Well, now one has to be a bit careful. We verified this for the electromagnetic potential. Now we have a more general operator B, and current divergence of the Dirac current is not zero for any choice of B. What we need is that this operator B is symmetric with respect to the spin inner product, provided that B of x is symmetric with respect to the spin inner product at the point x. That is, let me for clarity write this down. So this means that B of x psi phi x is the same as psi B of x phi sub x for all psi phi. Well, and then let's use this notation for all vectors in the spinner space at the point x. Okay, so therefore this symmetry of B, this is like a general condition on the form of the potential in the Dirac equation, and it turns out for all physically sensible potentials and interactions, this is always the case. So therefore we always assume that B of x is symmetric, and as a consequence, the Dirac current is divergence free. Okay, and now there is a corresponding conservation law, namely current conservation. And in the last video, I verified this by differentiating with respect to time. There is a more general, more conceptual way of getting the corresponding conservation law using the Gauss divergence theorem. Current conservation then follows from the Gauss divergence theorem. Let me explain this, because this is also good to know for later generalizations. And let's do this first of all for the situation we had In the previous video, so where we consider t equal constant hypersurface, suppose this is time t0. Of course, I plot here Minkowski space, so this is time, this is space. We have two times t0 and t1, and then we choose here omega as the region in between. And I should say this also works more generally. If we take cushy surfaces, let me also plot this here, then we can do both cases at once. But I don't want to give here a formal definition of what a cushy surface is. You can just think of it as a more general space-like hypersurface in Minkowski space, which we denote by n0 and n1. Okay, then if you want to apply the Gauss divergence theorem, we have to choose normal vector fields. But then this is easy how to do this here. We always consider future-directed normal. So here, so let's just plot it like this. And in here, the vector field is simply the d by dt vector field, or the vector field with components 1, 0, 0, 0. So this is the normal here. Well, if one has a more general cushy surface, then it looks somewhat like this. And I should point out for clarity that normal here refers to the Minkowski inner product. So therefore, drawing here 90 degrees might be a bit misleading. Nevertheless, I do it like this for simplicity. Okay, now suppose we have chosen these future-directed normals. Well, then let's begin with the divergence. So we know that the divergence of the Dirac current is equal to zero. Then, of course, integrating this, we still have zero. So therefore, zero is the integral over omega. Let's just write here the integration measure d mu. Well, this is nothing but d4x, just the usual integration measure in Minkowski space. Good, and now we can integrate by parts or apply the Gauss divergence theorem. And then we get, let me first of all write it down in the case of t equal constant surfaces, the similar to what we had in the last video. Then we get here the integral over j0 of, say, t1, x, d3x, minus the integral of g0 of t0, x, d3x. So this is current conservation here. Or if one works with these more general surfaces, let me just write down the formula here, then one has to take the current and take the normal component. Let's just write it like this, jk mu k, and we integrate over n1, and then here comes the induced volume measure on the Cauchy surface minus the integral over n0, jk mu k d mu n. Okay, I mean, this last formula, this is just like optional. In case you understand it, it's good, because then you see, okay, all these generalizes for what you really need here suffice to consider these integrals over the t equal constant hypersurfaces. Okay, so this is current conservation. And what is very useful is that this j0, if you write this down, this is psi of x times gamma 0 psi of x. And now the inner product here, including the gamma 0, is positive definite. So this inner product, so this is a scalar product, is positive, this is a scalar product. And likewise, in this more general setting of a general hypersurface, then if I take here Clifford multiplication with a future-directed normal vector field, this is again positive, just as again as a remark. Okay, and then we get an integral over something positive. It gives again like a makes it possible to introduce a scalar product on the solutions. This gives rise to a scalar product. On the solutions, which we usually denote like this. So phi psi phi, say at time t, is defined by the integral over R3. Well, and then we take here psi of x, gamma 0, let's write it without the x, just psi gamma 0 phi at t comma x vector, and then we integrate over space. So this is a scalar product on the solutions, and it is time independent. And everything here is well defined because we work with spatially compact, smooth solutions, so there's no problem. Okay, and now we can take the completion. Well, one can do this abstractly or whatever, using measure theory, taking the completion gives a Hilbert space. Let's denote it like this, H sub T, and then we have the corresponding scalar product here. Well, and this Hilbert space, this is the same as L2 of R3 with four components, so it's isomorphic to just the L2 space on any hypersurface. I mean, this is kind of obvious here because this here is nothing but psi dagger phi, is what how physicists write it, or we can also write it like this, psi phi, and this is just a C4 scalar product. Okay, so therefore, on any t equal constant surface, one has just the L2 scalar product, but everything is time independent, and this means that we have a unitary time evolution. So the fact that the scalar product is time independent, in other words, as a consequence of current conservation, gives rise to a unitary time evolution. We first of all write a corresponding formula. So we have here, say, map ut0 t1. This is a mapping from ht0 to ht1. It's a unitary. This is the time evolution operator. Okay, let me plot a picture. So again, here the two cushy surfaces, T0 and T1. The way to construct this unitary time evolution is as follows. Suppose we take here any smooth, compactly supported initial data. Then we know that the cushy problem can be solved. Well, I didn't prove it, but I mean, I mentioned it. And in any case, this is the case. So now we can solve the Cauchy problem, and then we get a corresponding Dirac solution, which has spatially compact support. So we have here psi at time t0 gives rise to a whole solution, and then we can evaluate this wave function at time t1. So we have, so therefore this ut1 t0 is simply mapping which psi at time t0 maps to psi at time t1. And the fact that there is a unique solution of the Cauchy problem, both forwards and backwards in time, really gives rise to makes this mapping well defined. And since the scalar product is time independent, this is an isometry, and well, it's invertible, and moreover, it's invertible, and well, and then going over to the completion, we get a unitary time evolution. Okay, so this is quite useful. On the other hand, it is often good not to think of the Dirac wave function as a function at different times, but instead to think of it as a global solution in space-time. So the more global point of view is to, well, forget about Cauchy surfaces, that we consider the wave function as globally in space-time, and then there is a scalar product, which I denote then usually like this, with a subscript m to indicate this is a scalar product on the solutions, and of course the mass enters the Dirac equation. Well, and this is then simply the same as this scalar product computed any time t, but of course we can choose an arbitrary time for any time t in R. Okay, and this gives me the Hilbert space of solutions, which I denote like this. So this is the Hilbert space of all Dirac solutions. Okay, maybe I should make a few remarks for all of those of you who know about PDEs. What is this solution space from a more, whatever, Sobolev space perspective? I mean, this space consists of weak solutions. More specifically, these solutions are in H 1, 2 log. Let's write it like this. So they are in the Sobolev space H 1, 2. So this means the first derivatives exist and are locally square integrable. Okay, and then using a kind of trace theorem. So trace theorem tells us if we restrict these Sobolev functions to hypersurfaces, in which space do we end up? And then we get here L2 log of whatever, of a hypersurface N. So this is the trace theorem. And moreover, the solutions are such that the restriction to any Cauchy surface is not only in L2 log, but it's in fact in L2. Namely, this L2 scalar product on the corresponding Cauchy surface is then just the Hilbert space scalar product. So this is how this can be understood from this PDE perspective. So we have weak solutions in the Sobolev space. The trace is in L2, where for L2 one has also to keep in mind that this normal vector field comes into play. You can, maybe it's better to think of it as a weighted L2 space, where this normal vector field gives a corresponding weight. And this L2 scalar product is even finite because it gives us the scalar product on the Hilbert space. Okay, good. I think we are almost at the end of this video, but there's one more thing I wanted to tell you about. Namely, there's also a Krein structure. And I wanted to tell you this mainly because there's also a corresponding Krein structure of the causal Fermion system later on. And of course, these structures correspond to each other. Namely, what one can do is the following. Suppose I take two wave functions, say psi phi. But now one has to be careful because you want to integrate over space-time. Let's assume that these wave functions are compactly supported. I should point out, not necessarily solutions. Not solutions of a Dirac equation. Well, then we can take this spin inner product at any space-time point, and now we can integrate this over space-time. And this gives an indefinite inner product, which we denote like this usually. Well, it is indefinite, of course, because the spin inner product is already indefinite, and then if you integrate it, it remains indefinite. One can also give this space a certain topology. Maybe I don't enter the details here, and then it is really like a Krein space. And what is important is that the Dirac operator is symmetric with respect to this Krein inner product. So this is kind of a general property of the Dirac operator, no matter which setting or which interaction you are looking at. The Dirac operator is symmetric with respect to this inner product. That is d psi phi is equal to, oh sorry, of course I should use the other brackets here, like this, is equal to psi d phi for all psi phi in, say again, compactly supported. Well, and this follows from the fact that the Dirac matrices are symmetric with respect to the spin inner product. The operator B is also symmetric, and then one can just integrate by parts and see that the Dirac operator is also symmetric. Okay, so this is this underlying Krein structure, which is sometimes very useful. And, well, in particular, because one has the symmetry of the Dirac operator, but it is an indefinite inner product space, and also one has to be careful about convergence of this integral. If one takes solutions of a Dirac equation, then this integral here will in general diverge. Well, in fact, the spatial integral is finite, no problem, because the functions are in L2 on any hypersurface, but the time integral will in general diverge. So therefore, with this Krein inner product, one has to be a bit careful, and it turns out the same is the case for this counterpart of the causal Fermin system later on. Okay, good. I think this is a good point to stop. And in the next video, I'll proceed with again a bit more physical video on the negative energy solutions and the Dirac C. Okay, I hope to see you again soon.